5-year-old on a piece of cardboard eating his dinner in the capital city, or kids in their school uniforms at night queuing at the GPO with their parents for a hot food that night and their lunch to be brought into school the next day. And that, but you might spare a thought for Jeff Bezos, because Jeff has been knocked off the top dog. He's no longer the richest man in the world.
Oh, no.
Oh. As usual, it's the fault of a woman. Jeff lost $30 billion in a divorce settlement after he had an affair and he sent nude, which apparently below the belt selfies is a thing. But it brought his wife up into the top 20, so at least there's a woman there. And now it means that Bill Gates is back on top where he was for 25 years as the richest man in the world. And before I leave, Jeff, I might mention that he's now pouring, you know, millions into trying to unseat in his home city of Seattle a socialist, feminist woman of colour, Shama Sawant, who he's trying to unseat her as the council member for the city for very obvious reasons, because she's the antithesis of what he represents, which is, you know, naked, greedy, exploitative. You know, you have your workers on a treadmill, quite literally, as we all know, the way that Amazon workers are exploited. And I think the other thing that I just have to mention is the horror of 39 people being found dead in a truck yesterday in Essex. And while capitalist governments in the EU, this is the EU, by the way, that we're daily exhorted to worship, you know, by our leaders in Ireland, have decided to close their borders to watch people literally die at sea. But not just watch, they're making sure that they're not rescued as well. Mm. Something that Fine Gael voted for, voted for in the European Parliament. And the purpose of that is to keep people out, but also to send a clear message to their native populations that these people, these brown, black, poor people, are to blame for the housing crisis, for, the health cut, health situation, not their policies of 8 men like Jeff and Bill controlling half of the wealth on the planet. Or sorry, not half of the wealth on the planet. They control the same amount of wealth as half of the people on the planet have. And it's against this backdrop of just unprecedented inequality, you know, that we're meeting here today, and I'm assuming everyone who's here in this room, that's essentially why we are here, is because we see what way the world is working. And I think probably the most inspiring and transformative political events that have happened in recent years have been the explosive movements and impact of young people and of women on the global political scene. It's already been mentioned, and I'm sure you've been discussing it earlier, in relation to climate change, how it's been forcefully put on the agenda like never before by young people in the last year, through strikes, through school shootings, not 20-somethings, not 30-somethings, but, you know, teenagers in the main. And 7 million in the most recent manifestation. In relation to women as well, we've seen Hollywood and Me Too. But we've seen at the other end, McDonald's workers, Google workers, taking strike action, even though they're not even in the union, they're not even represented. So they're therefore, you know, taking the biggest risk, if you like, to make statement about sexual harassment and also winning, by the way, better pay for women and for people of colour. We've seen as well the explosive movements that have taken place throughout Latin America with the Niño de Menos movement. Practically every country, even tragically, people might have seen the case in Bangladesh of the young woman who dared to pursue a case against a teacher for being sexually assaulted. and she was murdered for daring to pursue that case because obviously that is not the norm. And now, which will show you the change, but also that arrests have now been made because of this. I think it speaks volumes about the way that consciousness has changed. I was in a taxi there recently, and the taxi driver said Trump is he's such a misogynist. And I just thought to myself, 25 years ago, I was doing a degree in English in UCD. And during the exam, I saw loads of hands going up. Why are people putting their hands up asking? They obviously didn't understand the question. So I said to people after, why are you all putting your hands up? And they said, we didn't know what misogynist meant. Right? These were people doing a degree in literature in the biggest university in the country. And yet a taxi driver can turn to me and say, Trump's a misogynist, without batting an eyelid. So I think it says it all about the shift in consciousness that can take place. And why is that shift taking place? Because of movements like the repeal movement, you know, that all of us here played a role in, the movement for marriage equality, and so many other things. And I think that's what we take our lead from, that we can shift people's ideas, you know, very quickly when a social movement takes place. And I think consciousness has been raised massively about gender. We've seen it when you see it on the athletics track, and I'm sure Suzanne was talking earlier, and on the sports arena. Well, then it just really reflects what's going on outside, like we would have seen in the 60s, and we haven't seen for 50 or 60 years, people like Muhammad Ali and the Olympians and so on. Now we've got the likes of Colin Kaepernick, the US women's soccer team, people chanting in the stadium. And I think it brings home, there's a realisation among growing numbers of people that the system that we have, capitalism, it needs racism, it needs sexism, it needs ethnic and religious division, as well, of course, its core inequality of class division, which it has to have, that's the basis of capitalism, that's what's necessary to maintain Jeff and Bill and all of the others at the top of society, exploiting the people who toil and actually create their wealth in the first place, often children, by the way, who create that wealth. And I think in Ireland we've seen the repeal campaign was a reflection of that, a historic victory for women. I know Leo and Simon think otherwise, and so do a few people who are writing a book now. That was just four people who led together for yes. Actually, we need to remind them it was a movement of people from below over a whole period of time. It was working class women, LGBT plus people played a key role, and working class communities. And it's not over yet because it's unfinished business. And these people, they want to wrap themselves in the cloak of having played a role in that, which we know they didn't. But just some quick statistics, like women, twice as likely to be earning the minimum wage. We know the gender pay gap is actually rising, not going down. The unpaid labour of women, $10 trillion a year. So imagine, you know, capitalism just absolutely rests on gender inequality and rigid gender roles and promoting them because it's very profitable to do so. A stark statistic, lone parents, they're not just twice as likely to be in poverty as somebody who, a two-parent family. Their net income is likely to be seven times lower. You know, and I think that says it all about the burden, and I have a child, but the burden of childcare if you don't have outlets for women who still have the responsibility or the stress. We were doing a survey in Dublin West recently where we were just talking to women about issues, and the trend was people saying, I just can't sleep at night because I'm worrying about who am I going to get to mind the kids on Tuesday, who am I going to get to mind them on Wednesday, how am I going to get from A to B to Z. And the responsibility is still resting on working class women to do all of these things. And we know that it doesn't have to be this way because we have the resources, we have the technology to deal with all of the ills of society. We could very easily, if you had a socialist government, socialist society, build homes for people who need them, I know they make out that it's very difficult, but it's actually quite simple. The way to end homelessness is building houses. And, you know, that is it. There is no other solution. By building homes on the public lands that we have available, that the state has in its disposal, we're free childcare. Why not? Like primary school, secondary school, we expect those to be free. We've just, you know, these are things that we now accept. It wasn't that way 40 years ago. And why wouldn't schools that are lying vacant after school be used? Or community buildings? And have a state childcare system. Similarly with transport, free public transport to tackle the nightmare of climate change and create, you know, much easier life for working people. And it's so possible if we had the wealth that I spoke about at the start, owned, controlled and planned by the people who actually create it. I don't want to go on too long, I know there's been a number of other speakers, but we want to as well have economic freedom, but we also want to obliterate sexism, misogyny and violence against women. We want to transform culture. Like I spoke about with Michael, look at the change that's brought about and how women are, you know, asserting themselves in a way that was never seen before in this country. And I just want to finish with a quote from Alexander Ocasio-Cortez. You know, somebody who is part of a group of socialists in the belly of the beast of capitalism. Socialism is becoming such a popular concept in the US because of the horror show that they have leading their country, obviously, as well as the massive inequality that capitalism is, even if Trump wasn't leading the country. But alongside Sanders and other socialists, and I mentioned Chalmers a lot as well, she endorsed Bernie Sanders and the idea of not just a vote, but building a mass movement. And we have to now, I would appeal to anybody here, to have a discussion now about how we are going to challenge this horror show that we are being faced with, that's taken away futures for young people, literally. So she, I've just finished with the quote that she said when she was endorsing Bernie Sanders. We need to have a revolution of working class people, and it needs to be multiracial, multigendered, and multigenerational. Our future is not going to get better unless we demand it and unless we work for it. So let's take that message and go out now and build that movement. Thanks.